But this is a team government that is painting to you a very, very simplistic narrative of history. What happened after they made their speech? Let's clarify that. This side of the house, the honorable leader of the opposition got up and said, we have two fundamental problems with what they're saying. Problem number one is on a moral plane, and problem number two is on a practical plane. Now, I'll concede we don't want to argue with you about the quantum of the reparations, but let's keep these two things in your mind, and by the end of the next 7 minutes, I'm hoping that we would have persuaded you why we win this debate. Problem number one is the moral ground, and problem number two is the practical ground, right? Now, Aisha got up and said that she did not equate taxes with reparations. But let me tell you why and how she did that. We asked them a question when the honorable leader of the opposition was speaking. She got up and said, when Hamad was making the point that the state does not have the moral authority to collect these reparations, because if there is any beneficiary of the colonial system today, any entity that has benefited from the colonial system, it is the state of Pakistan and India and Bangladesh. Why? Because we kept the strong executive, we kept the centralized authority, we kept the idea of creating new identities and marginalizing people's inherent identities, whether they be ethnic, linguistic, or religious, right? So the question was that if you want to pay reparations to the state, our claim was the state is not the entity that has the moral authority to collect them. Aisha got up and said, don't you trust the state to collect taxes? And then she got up here and said, I'm not equating the two. Well, you are. Because if it comes down to moral authority, if it comes down to moral authority, the state may have the moral authority to collect taxes because we owe allegiance to the Constitution, but we are not going to go so far and say that the greatest beneficiary of the project of colonialism today has the moral authority to force people to give them reparations. So that's why that's different. So that's where the moral authority point, I'll just take that in. The second point, they're being clearly very state-like. You know, it's almost amusing, were it not so depressing. Because they're saying, well, there was a Gallup poll, and people have all kinds of crazy ideas about our history, and therefore we need to send out the message. So, in order to make up for the failures of the state in creating enough awareness about Pakistan's real problems, they're being very Pakistan state-like by saying, oh, let's start collecting money from all these people, even though we do not have a moral case. If anyone, maybe the Punjab textbook board owes all of us reparations. I mean, I think this is all something that all of us can agree on, especially those of us who went through the metric and the inter system. But, you know, the point is there's no moral authority with the state that rests there. Now, they said to you that we do not
on that point, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, what you're saying is that the state is absolutely barred from taking any actions to dilute the effects of colonialism because it's a benefit.
No, so I'll come down to the why it's wrong for the state also, but also why on moral authority anyone should not be paying reparations for what happened, right? Now let's start with that. We said, firstly, that we have a problem with your chain of authority. They said, well, liability attaches to assets. Well, assets keep changing hands, firstly. How do you trace this asset? We have a practical problem with this idea of tracing the asset. Secondly, what if my grandfather, great-grandfather, gave my grandfather some piece of land and he worked immensely hard and then added to that and built up a factory? But that land is still there. They're going to make that hard-working person pay reparations because he had nothing to do with it, and even though he has to pay the sins of, you know, grandfather. No. You specifically said that don't you think any individuals, at least point of information to the honorable leader of the opposition was, don't you think that individuals benefited from colonialism? He specifically asked that point of information, you remember? And the answer is, yes, they did. So you should have gone after those individuals who benefited from colonialism and not their descendants. Because a lot of people, this is where it runs into serious problems on the moral and practical plane again.
Yes, sir.
Take Zulfiqar Ali Bhutto and his family, for example. Could anybody say that they did not benefit from colonialism? They did, yes. I mean, they got titles, they got lands, so on and so forth. And now they want to go after the family of somebody like Zulfiqar Bhutto, who, whether or not you agree with him, is a person who faced severe oppression from Pakistan's, you know, dictators, was hanged, his daughter was subsequently killed. All of this happened in this country. So they're saying to you that their moral case is that just because someone's great-grandfather accepted a grant, that is the only thing that will define their children and their grandchildren as far as their assets are concerned. How is that morally fair? Because you may have been a nationalist, you may have been somebody who lived in East Pakistan, fought either for West Pakistan or East Pakistan. You may have been someone who had their factory confiscated when Bhutto nationalized those. You may have been Zulfikar Ali Bhutto. Where is the distinction between each one of these cases? So that's the severe problem that we have.
Sir, isn't the liability of any wrongdoing that an individual does attached to their estate and survive their demise?
No, so that's that. So we're saying that that's, you're assuming what you have to prove. Because if it attaches to the state and if the estate was simply untouched by nobody else and they were hiding it away somewhere, then maybe you would have had a case. But you're saying this happened a long time ago. Now other people have worked on that asset. They have contributed their own sweat and blood. People have generated jobs. People have worked hard on that land. They've done a number of other things. They've faced